Today we are going to invite our wonderful speakers, Dr. Rubina Barolia and Yasmin Karim. They will be with us for next 3 weeks, and they are going to take us on a journey. Journey of miracles of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, and all the miracles from the Quranic point of view. So let us all welcome our honored speakers, Yasmin Karim and Dr. Rubina Barolia.
Thank you one and all. And Nimet mentioned, our topic today is miracles of Hazrat Musa. Who can guess what this is? If we are talking about Hazrat Musa, the baby in this painting is Hazrat Musa. Anyone want to guess who this is?
His sister, Mary.
Yes, exactly, Miriam. Okay, that's Hazrat Musa's sister. And Hazrat Musa's mom, yeah, Yochabed. Or the other pronunciation is Yochabed. Let's continue and explore the miracles of Hazrat Musa. So we know that the time he was born was the time when Pharaoh was the king and he used to listen to his astrologers. So one of his astrologers told him that there will be a born from the Israelites who is going to kill you or take over the kingdom. So Pharaoh killed 90,000 Israelite babies. It's amazing how Hazrat Musa is born, right? So we can see that Yochabed actually met her husband. The point of reflection is at that time all the men were in prison. So how they met is documented in the Holy Quran. It's a miracle itself. When Yochabed gave birth to Hazrat Musa, she actually hid him for 3 months. When she no longer could, God gave her ilham or a message internally that she should not fear, that God would take care of Hazrat Musa himself. As a mother continued to worry, so then God told Yochabed to put Hazrat Musa in a basket and let it flow in the river Nile. So Miriam followed the basket, which landed up in Pharaoh's castle. And we know that he was brought up in the castle. It's important point here to note that Pharaoh's wife, Hazrat Asiya, is considered a hujjat. So she was not an ordinary woman. And we see that her spirituality and eminence is celebrated along with other great women in this very beautiful hadith. Once the Holy Prophet drew 4 lines on the ground and asked people, "Do you know what this is?" They said, "God and His Prophet know best." Right? So then the Holy Prophet said that they are the first, Hazrat Fatima, daughter of Muhammad, Hazrat Khadija, daughter of Walid, Hazrat Maryam, daughter of Imran, and here we come, Asiya, right? Daughter of Muzahim, wife of Pharaoh. So this actually also proves and tells us that she was not an ordinary woman, right? And of course, then the Holy Prophet continues to say that they have superiority over all the women in paradise, okay? And this parable, or this very beautiful example that God gives in the Holy Quran by mentioning Asiya in her prayer, that she said to God, "Oh my Lord, build for me a house in your neighborhood." It's provocative, right? How can there be a house near God in paradise? So again, it just, remember the first time when we connected, I was using that formula of the square, circle, and triangle. So again, if we relate this to that, it's so beautiful, we realize that actually building a house in the neighborhood of God refers to our own personal world, right? It is at the level of intellect. So there are 9 miracles of Hazrat Musa. So the first miracle is the miracle of Asa, which is the rod or the staff of Hazrat Musa. The second miracle is Yadideza, the white hand. The third miracle is Sinin, drought. Fourth is Tufan, deluge. Fifth is Jarad, okay, Loctus. The next one is Kumal, Okay, rice, followed by the Fadi, frogs, the miracle of the frogs, followed by the miracle of dam, blood, how the river Nile turns into blood, right? And last, the miracle of Luxin, Venus Samarat, okay? So those are the 9 miracles. Today, I'm going to touch on the first miracle, which is the miracle of Asa. Asa is the staff, the rod of Hazrat Musa, and it's mentioned 10 times in the Holy Quran. Its symbolic meaning is Ismi Azam. It's the miracle of the prophets and the imams. Story where the staff turns into a serpent and engulfs all other serpents. It's a beautiful symbol. It symbolizes Ismi Azam, the teachings, the luminous knowledge of the prophets and the imam, which swallow up all the doubts, all the insinuations, all the filth and dirt that comes or that corrodes true knowledge, okay? So that's the meaning of the miracle of Asa. So next we have Yadebeza. Yadebeza is the white hand of Moses. I'm sure we've heard that many a times. We can draw a parallel with our fourth part of Dua, where we say Yadullahi Fawqaydihim, right? So the miracle of Yadebeza refers to the intellect and the universal soul and the universal intellect, okay? And how the miraculous knowledge of Hazrat Musa actually scattered pearls, just like Hajj Imam is doing today through his speeches and his farmans. Because remember, in Ismailism, everything is alive. So what lessons do we get from this miracle of Yadebeza, right? How can we relate it to ourselves today in our lives and in our personal world? So we see the miracle of Yadebeza today in the form of all APBN projects, like Hajj Imam is doing this miracle today, right? And sustaining us intellectually and spiritually. I'm going to end here and let Dr. Rubina take over. We can continue on with Q&A after. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Yasmin, for sharing this 9 miracle, which is listed in Quran. So I'll share my screen. You can see the slides, right?
Yes, we can.
Okay, thank you. So if we, maybe you must have heard a lot of miracles and lot of narration about Hazrat Musa, and it is mentioned in the Quran. And Hazrat Musa's stories, Hazrat Musa's miracles are widely narrated and mentioned in the Quran. So it is said that one of the most ayahs are focused on Musa's story. So there are a lot of things we need to learn from Hazrat Musa's story. Those stories are esoterically mentioned in the Quran, and some of the tafsir, some of the explanations, and Islamic narration, Sunni narration, Shia narration have also mentioned in Tafsir Quran, which is the book for stories of prophets and the most widely read poem story is Hazrat Musa and Hazrat Isa. So we're going to mention few of the narrations or few of items, concepts which Hazrat Musa has its journey in the spirituality and in the intellectual arena. So one of the story of Hazrat Musa is of mentioned in Al-Kahf, which is Surah number 18, and this is the story of Hazrat Musa's journey and Musa's journey with Khidr. So Khidr is we'll see who is Khidr and how his journey takes place. There are almost 22 ayat in the series. If you read Surah Al-Kahf, which is chapter 18, and from 60 to 82, it goes from first part is about the Musa's narration. We all know that one of the titles of Hazrat Musa, I'll use the word Hazrat Musa, not the Buddhist. So Hazrat Musa is the title is Kalimullah. So he is actually communicating and conversing with or doing salam with Allah. So he continuously talking to Allah and many of the things they both were discussing. So one part is that narration. The second part is the 4 to 5 ayahs where Musa, before the journey, what Musa, how Musa finds Khidr. And then part three is the journey itself with Musa and Khidr. So where they go, what they have done, what actions did Hazrat Khidr have done during that time. And then part four is the reasons which Hazrat Khidr explains to Hazrat Musa that why he has done those actions. So that will be easy for us. And if we finish all four parts today, it's fine. Otherwise, I'll stop at the 9 so that we can ask the question and answer. So first part is about the narration. There are a lot of stories and a lot of physical esoteric stories in Tafsir. Ibn Abbas Tafsir is commonly read among Shias and Shia Muslims. So he writes that at the time of Musa's conversation with Allah, he was saying to Musa that I had a lot of knowledge and you have given me a lot of bounties, you have given me a lot of knowledge, and I am the one who knows the best. In one narration, it says that Allah didn't like the way he was saying that I am the one who knows the best and I have an abundance of knowledge. God says that no, there is one more person who has more knowledgeable than you. In one narration, it says that Musa actually was being Shukar Guzari and then thanking God that, Allah, you have given me a lot of knowledge, you have given me a lot of bounty. But is there any other person who has the same amount of knowledge other than me or like more knowledge than me? Then Allah replies that there is a person who is more knowledgeable than you. And then when Allah says that thing to Musa, then Musa says that please indicate who is that person. And Allah replies that Khidr is more knowledgeable than you. So if you see the name Khidr is not in Quran, but all the Tafsir say that that person was Khidr. And Musa said that where should I seek him out? Allah replied that where two oceans meet. So the place where two oceans meet, that is the reply Allah gave to Musa. And then Musa also asked this and how I could recognize him. So Allah said that take a fish with you in a basket and you start your journey. When that fish becomes alive, that is the point where you will see that you will find Khidr. And then Musa and one of his companion people said that it's Yusha bin Nun, who is a butcher at the time, a servant. They both went and started the journey. And Musa says to his servant that I will do journey. I will not stop going back until I arrive at the junction of the two seas. And I will travel infinitely. If I have to, then I will do that. So this is the exoteric story, and I have covered part one here, where you will find these Tafsirs in the stories of the Musa and Khidr. Then, now they have traveled, and they were talking. Meanwhile, they both reached to the junction of two seas. Now here there are a few reflections we need to know. There are two things. One, Allah has indicated that when take a fish and when fish becomes alive. So some story says that they have roasted a fish. Some story says that they have taken uncooked. Some story says that they have taken cooked food, fish. So whatever fish that they have taken it, so they actually, when they were traveling, they had stopped somewhere and then they again started to travel. So at one point in time, when they saw the junction of two seas. Now here, there is a point of reflection is that what is the link of the fish with the spirituality, and why it is important for us for nowadays, like why this fish is important and this kind of miracle, how could we do that? We take a fish and where is the figure, and it's very difficult. So if Quran is the book of teaching, then what this story is teaching us, what fish is teaching us, what the junction of two seas or junction of two oceans is teaching us. And there is also a point of reflection that why Allah has not given any place, identifying any place in the map that this is the place, this is the town, this is the address, or maybe this is where you can find it in that community or in that household or whatever at that time the addresses were indicated. So Allah has given the two junction of two seas. There is a lot of esoteric meaning in it, Vatini meaning in it. So when they go teach at the junction of two seas and it says that, okay, here, if they say that here, they think that we need to stop here, and they were hungry, so Musa asked that, okay, come on. Take out that fish, we are hungry and we need to eat that fish. So the servant says that, I forgot that the fish was alive at that rock where we have stopped for a while, and now I focus there, and I focus to mention you, and the fish made its way into the sea in a strange way. So they identify a place where a fish became alive, and that was the place where the junctions of the two seas was identified, and at that point in time, they can find figure. So there are three things in it. So there are a lot of study behind fish, junctions of two seas, and figure. So for fish, in our diaries and our Buddhism Deen, there are multiple meanings of fish, but one important meaning of fish, which is in a proper noun mentioned in Quran, is Zanmun, which is in the story of Hazrat Yunus, and Al-Hawd. Al-Hawd, if you put Al in front of a noun, then it becomes a proper noun. So this is not an ordinary fish. Al-Hawd is mentioned in ayat number 63 in Hazrat Musa's story, and Zanmun is mentioned in Hazrat Yunus' story. So Noon is mentioned in Musa's story. So Al-Hawd, which is fish, the fish. So this fish is not an ordinary, so its story is Ibn Azam. So Allah has given an Ibn Azam to Musa for his bigger journey. And this journey is not somewhere else. In the worldly journey, this is not the physical journey, this is the journey of the personal God. Spiritual journey of the personal world of Musa. So we can learn from this lesson that fish is a tawi of fish, is Ibn Azam, and Imam of the time is giving, is the ta'weez of Allah is Imam. And Imam is giving fish to all of us to take it with us until that fish becomes alive. Then Ismi Azam becomes alive. So the next portion is the junction of two oceans. So Musa had carried Ismi Azam within his personal world, and he was exercising this Ismi Azam. He was reciting, doing bandagi, and doing etika. And at the time where that Ismi Azam becomes alive, means the word Ismi Azam or a verbal Ismi Azam, which is given to all of us, then that becomes embodied Ismi Azam, which is called Shakti Ismi Azam or Nurani Ismi Azam. Ismi Azam, when it becomes alive, it becomes new and it opens, and then it speaks inside us. So when Ismi Azam speaks, then it becomes automatic. When this has become automatic, right now we do dhikr, we do it with our tongue, our physical tongue or a tongue of heart, like yadi, 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 and that's the azam, and it becomes automatic. You do not need to move your tongue, but it repeats itself. So that is where its azam becomes alive, it becomes durani, and Imam also in his parami says that when the light comes to you, and when it becomes, when the Adam will birth, you will definitely going to know. So you know that you have reached to the level where if the Adam becomes automatic, and Arif or a Mu'min at that point knows that now my Adam becomes automatic, that means the word is the Adam or a verbal is the Adam, which is given to that moment, or which is given to us, or given to Ari, after doing the bandagi and after doing the spiritual exercises, that Ismi Azam becomes alive. And that is basically the fish got alive during Musa's journey. So now we can relate that with to the personal world, to the spiritual city, and to the spiritual process. Now, that zikr becomes automatic at the time, and when the zikr becomes automatic, you reach to a destiny. So that reaching for every morning, every hour, every prophet needs to go at a higher level, at a place of a junction, at a place of confluence of two oceans, which is in Quran, it's in Jumawi Bahrain. And in here, if I show you this word, okay, not in here, but in later word, the word is that Allah is saying that you will find Khidr at Majmu'i Bahrain, at the junction of two oceans. So the junction of two oceans, where the fish become automatic, then this may Adam become automatic, that means that there is a place you will reach to the junction of two oceans, which is Majmu'ul Bahrain. And in that Majmu'ul Bahrain, there are lots of miracles is happening. So every prophet, every awliya, every arif, when they start their journey of Ismi Azam, they reach up to the level of automatic, the zikr becomes automatic, and they reach up to the level of junctions or a confluence of two oceans or the two worlds. So we need to understand, and there are a lot of explanation given in a lot of books, in a lot of Dari books, and even Allama Sahib also have explained that what is Majmu'ul Bahrain. In Surah Rahman also, it is indicated that in Jannat or in Paradise, there are duality, there are always two mevas or two fruits. And here in this world also there is a junction. So there is a concept of duality, and everything is contained in Manifest Imam. There is an ayah where it says that everything is contained in Manifest Imam, and they are in duality or in self except Allah. So Allah is one, beneath that everything is in duality. So the notion of duality, one leads up to that majmoo dhahrein, where the two ideas meet or where the two opposite things meet, then this creates action. Like for example, Azal and Abad. There is a place where Azal and Abad meet. Rahir and Batin meet. This life and the life after meet. Universal soul and universal intellect meet. Heaven and earth, the junction of the heaven and the earth. The junction of angel and man. Junction of intellect and soul. So there are a lot of examples where the two opposite things meet. That is called the junction. Because at that junction, you will identify, or we are, or those who are in the spiritual journey will identify that what junctions are those, and like word and action, visible and invisible. So these all are junctions, and there is a lot of knowledge behind those junctions. It is also very important that this spirituality, and at that Majmaul Bahrain, Mu'min is given a lot of knowledge. Mu'min is given ilm. Mu'min is given ta'weed. Mu'min is given knowledge which Imam has. So at that level, it is important to reach. So Musa was doing the journey, his ism become automatic, and then he reached to at the junction at the Majmaul Bahrain, where he is going to find lot of knowledge, lot of tawil, lot of understanding of Islam, and it's all the knowledge in this world and the year after understanding is at the junction of two oceans. So now, in this junction, never failed. Now, who was Khidr? There are lot of stories about Khidr. You may know that Khidr, somebody says that Khidr was a prophet, and Khidr has, that story says that he has drunk water of life, which is called Abu Hayat, ever living, and Khidr, the term Khidr means green. Khidr Akhtar. Akhtar is the color green, which means ever living. So green color means hayat or life, and Khidr is termed as a person who is ever living. And it is said that in the story, it is said that there is zulamat, where or a darkness, and there is a spring of water of life is found at the place of zulamat, and if you drink that water, then you become, you will not die. So that is just the story. Even if it is said that Zulamat is an ocean where you find Abi Hayat, or where you find water of life, then it means that Zulamat is basically ignorance, and once you really get rid of the ignorance, then you become alive. So Hazrat Khidr actually is a true Gawi. And this is the title of Imam. And basically, Khidr is a prophet, and he died in his own time. But the word Khidr is also related to the Imam, because he is always present in this world. He is guiding, and he is guiding all of us, all Muslims and all Smilies, all his community, to the water of resurrection, which is the water of life. So, in reality, this recognition is the water of life, of feeling, which a Mu'min becomes ever living spiritually, but not physical. So, the water of life, or Abi Hayat, is not a physical water, it's not a physical ocean, but this is the spiritual, because you get panafillah, we get panafillah in Imam, and that the Imam of the time is always there, so in his mood, we become alive all the time. And this is not physically, because Quran rejects that anyone can live without tasting death. In Quran, Allah says that everyone will go through death, or everyone will taste death. Har kisi ko maut ka maza chakhna hai. So this is the ayah. So everyone will go through death, and no one will alive forever physically. That is the two ayat in the Quran that means that there is no such thing available in this world like Abil Hayat, which is for anyone to possible that Hazrat Khizr or Hazrat Isa is physically live forever. And even practically all scientists, even health scientists, have not been able to find such water of life or any such technology where on the earth we can say that by doing these things, by taking these medications, or these are the health necessity or these perspectives, if we can take it, you will not die. So it is not possible for anyone to live forever. So this means that Khizr is the title of Imam, and this Abil Hayat is actually Imam of Quran. So this is the title of the Imam of Quran. Okay, so now he's coming to the journey. So now we have set two phases. That one is the narration where Musa and his students were talking during the journey. There was a time the fish became alive, the algorithm became automatic, and they reached to Majmur Banan, where they find Khizr. Now, what Khizr has done the action, so there are a few ayahs, which I'm going to read it, and then you can also read on your own. Chapter number 18, ayah 65 to 78. Is about the journey. So in 65, Allah says that they found one of the servants on whom we had bestowed mercy from ourselves, who is Khizr, and we had sought knowledge from our presence. Then Musa says to him, "Can I stay with you?" Musa is saying to Khizr that, "Can I stay with you under this condition that you will teach me some knowledge which has been conferred to you by Allah?" So Khizr said, "No doubt you will not be able to have patience in my company." So here patience is what also very important, and you know patience is in sabr, and sabr is not the ordinary sabr. We had a lecture earlier that what sabr means, and so we're not going to discuss that, but sabr is also very important when you meet Khizr at the confluence of two oceans. So and how you can observe patience which you will have not acquired knowledge. So Khizr was saying that until and unless you will not have the patience, it is not possible for anyone to acquire knowledge. So Musa said, "You will certainly find me patient, that you will certainly find me among Sabirin or Sabir. If Allah so pleases, then I will not violate any of your instructions." So Khizr said, "So if you are in my company, then do not question me about anything until I myself mention that to you." So now questioning what is going to happen. So the spiritual journey, when Arif or Prophet or Aulia go through the spiritual journey, there are many things happening during the journey. And sometimes there are some questions come to our mind. So that's what Khizr is claiming, that do not question my action. So both of them then set out, and they embarked on a boat, and Khizr bored a hole in it. And Musa said, "Have you bored a hole to drown the people aboard? Surely you have done something strange." So, in this life, first action which Khizr has Satan is he bore the hole in a boat. And then Musa has questioned that, why did you do that? This is the boat of poor people, and they were earning from that, and this is not a good thing you have done. So figure that, did I not tell you that you would not be able to restrain yourself in my company? Musa again said, call me not to account for my omission and put me not in any more difficulty. Next time I will be careful. So then both of them proceed and they match a boy, a young boy. And figure killed him. Musa said, have you killed an innocent soul without any retribution due for anyone killed? Indeed, you have done a horrible thing. So again, Figure said that, did I not tell you that you were never able to keep patience in my company? Then again, Musa said that, if I ask you about anything after this, then don't keep me with you. Indeed, in my opinion, you have reached the limit to excuse. Then both set off until they reached the people of town, and they both asked the residents for the food, because in the journey they were very tired and they were hungry, so they asked the residents of the town to give the food, but they refused and to give them the food. Then they found a wall which was about to fall. So Khidr constructed that wall or erected it. Then Musa again asked that, if you desire, you could take wages for this. And he questioned in some explanation, it is also mentioned that Musa again questioned that they have not given us the food, and they were like not cooperating, very cooperative with us. And while you are building or constructing this wall, so then Khidr said that this is the parting time between me and you. Now I impart to you the truth of the matter about which you have not been able to keep patient. So three actions Khidr has done. Number one is he bore a hole in a boat of poor people. The second one is he killed a boy without any reason. And the third one is he built a wall or a construct a wall in a community where they were refused to be given the food to them. So that's the three actions done. This was till 78, ayat number 78. Now from 79 to 82, Khidr is giving the answers of these three. So first one, Khidr is saying that as for the boat that belongs to is some question, or you can hear my voice?
Yeah, yeah, I can hear you. Go ahead.
Okay. So as for the boat, this is mentioned in Quran. I'm reading translation. So in ayat number 79, Khidr is explaining, as for boat that belong to poor people who used to toil for the wages on the river. So I decided to make it defective. Right, and I made the hole because it becomes defective. And a cruel king was standing ahead of them, and he was ready to snatch that boat. So now it is defective, so he will not snatch, and they will continue their daily wages with that boat. So that was the reason Caesar said to Musa. Then the second one, which is the saving of the boy, he said that as for the boy, his parents were blessed with faith, so he feared that if he lived on, he would become a disbeliever and attaining to maturity, so he would afflict both of them with disobedience and disbelief. So we intend that Lord might bless them with such a substitute and would be better than this boy in purity. So he killed the boy because when he grew in the maturity, he became disbeliever and disobedient. So Khidr killed him so that his parents were very pure, so they could not see that. The third, which is about the constructing the wall, he said that as for the wall that belongs to two orphan boys residing in the town, and the treasure was buried beneath it for both of them. And their father was a pious man. So your laws wish that both of them should reach their age of the maturity without the treasure themselves by mercy of God, and I did not do on anything on my own accord. This is the truth of the matters about which you could not hold yourself. So these are the three reasons Caesar gave, but still these are the physical, esoteric reasons, and there is a vastly aspect. Because even if these are the three reasons, what is the lesson for us? What is the lesson for a boring hole in the boat? What is the lesson of killing young boy, and what is the lesson of building a wall? Today, in this context, in this world, would we be able to do something on some other people's property, anything, seeing that they will be using something? So, world is changed, world is changing, and he will not get any lesson until unless he goes through the Bhakini perspective or the Ruhani perspective. So, boring the hole in the boat, actually, it's the spiritual progress, a level after the Azam become automatic. There is a hole is done where, like, it's not hole physically being done, but there is a hole in our spiritual journey where every soul can enter into the person who is going through the resurrection. So this is the Ruhani Qiyamah or spiritual resurrection, which is step one, where every soul can enter into the personal world of Musa, personal world of Unihari, personal world of Odia, or personal world of all those who have reached up to the level of Qiyamah, or the level of the personal journey. And the boat belongs to Turkey, means Imam of the time. So Imam of the time actually is a poor in a sense that he gave this resurrection in a person. It seems there's a lot of things going on, a lot of difficult time, physical is going on, and because Imam of the time wants to purify the full range of particles inside the person. So we have all the particles. Some of the particles are alive, some of the particles are dormant, some of the particles are dead. But after this hole, all the particles become alive, and that is a kind of a physical journey, and it's a very difficult time to pass through. So this is the beginning phase of speciality, a phase before that complete progress or luminous begins. So this, at this time, luminous Kedar is not going to happen, so it is a kind of a defensive boat. Boat is, you know, the Ishti Enijat of the boat, but it is defensive because the full range of luminous Kedar is still behind and still a stage needs to be crossed. Killing of boy, even in any Sharia and any laws of any prophet, it is not commanded by the prophet or by anyone. That person who is innocent and yet not guilty can be given punishment. So there is a and given the punishment for if there is a fear that he may commit a crime in future. So nobody kills or nobody gives punishment to anyone who has not yet done any crime. So, and this is in Sharia, in laws, this is not possible. So how can Krishna kill the boy without any sin being done or any crime being done? So killing of the boy was not in a physical sense. It's the boy is a carnal soul. When our nafs-e ammara is at the level of youth, then at that time, Musa and Aulia and Arif needs to kill the carnal soul, which is Nafs-e Ammara. And we all know the famous this hadith that dies visually before you die physically. So this is the lesson that until and unless the carnal soul, which is very rebellious, and if you grow and if you give the food and if you will not take care of the carnal soul, then when we grow up, then we become rebellious, and then our intellect, which is the father, and our spiritual, our spirit, which is the mother. So the intellectual capabilities and the spiritual capabilities will be under control of carnal soul. When we give lot of things to carnal soul and we do not do anything about the carnal soul, then we can become the more rebellious against our spirit and against our intellect. So the mother and the father who are fire, which is the spirit, or the intellectual abilities and the spiritual abilities, are mother and the father, or an obstacle or obstacle is the spiritual ability. The third action was building the wall for two orphans. Orphan in is in Urdu and in Arabic is yatim. So in yatim, one of the meaning of yatim is yadana or unique. So one of the title of imam is a unique word, durre yatim. So durre yatim is one of the titles of yatim, and orphan means yatim. And in many other surah where yatim is mentioned, that do not push yatim means do not push imam's talima. So this durre yatim is a unique word. And it is also a pearl producing ocean itself. So pearl, which is the true imam who has a treasure of knowledge, and the two orphans are this Imam-e Mustauda and Imam-e Mustafa. We all know by now that there are imams' titles and the two main titles of imam or two type of imam are one is Imam-e Mustauda and other is Imam-e Mustafa, and trusted imam or permanent imam. And the wall beneath the treasure was hidden is also mentioned in Surah Hadid. Surah Hadid it is said that we have separated the zahir and batin with a wall. So that wall is basically the wall where you, where imam built in our personality, in all of our personality. So until and unless we go to the resurrection, or a person goes to the resurrection, woman goes through the resurrection, then only at that time this wall is being this treasure can be identified after when the wall is being deconstructed or we fall apart that wall. So between Zahir and the Batin. So that is Tawil of Khidr and Musa. So now the three points or three actions of Israel is connected to us. So first of all is building the wall, where at the time there is a stage of the spirituality comes where imam of the time gives some trials and tribulations of resurrection, where our all dormant selves become alive. Then it's our carnal soul we move to kill, so that we can move towards the spirituality. And then imam of the time actually has built that wall so that we cannot see Zahir and Batin together until unless we reach at a certain level of spirituality where we see the Batin. So this is all done by Khidr alayhi salam, actions done by imam of the time. And today also Khidr of the time can do these actions to any moment who can reach up to that level and who can have the journey of the Musa, that Musa which at his time we can do, or anyone of any moment can take this journey along. So in my concluding ashar, our share, Khidr is the imam of the time, and title of the Imam is given. And there's a word where it says, Ae Noor-e Ilahi, tu hame apni mita de, and Fizr-e Zaman, Pehle Khuda, Aave Baka de. Like, Ae Noor-e Ilahi, which is Ae Noor of Allah, please give us the luminous didar. The luminous didar which is the highest didar. And highest didar, and Ae Fizr-e Zaman, Ae Imam-e Zaman, for God's sake, give us Aave Baka, give us water of life. So this is the dua. We all can pray that we can reach up to the level and see the exact journey which Musa has done the journey at this time. So I'll stop here and time is up, so ready for the question and answer. Thank you.
Subhanallah, subhanallah. Wonderful explanation with so much detail. I truly was amazed listening to it. Friends, you are welcome to ask questions, please. I think it was a lot to, you know, reflect and think. It was such a beautifully done with all the information, all the knowledge, full of esoteric knowledge. It was wonderful. I still don't see any questions. I'll just comment on one thing. Recently, somebody was asking, Qira is Imam, and then I learned that in your presentation, Qira is also known to be a prophet. Amazing lecture. Yes. I do see a question, Dr. Sava. I've heard from one of the sessions that during the final spiritual resurrection of Aris, sins of all humanity are forgiven by Mala. So I need a clarification about forgiveness of sins. So the sins forgiven by Mala are related to only religious sins like Dua, Bulchuk, Dasun Bulchuk. All forgiven sins are also related to worldly sins that we committed, like gossiping, lying, backbiting, or any other worldly sins that we can think of. It is totally not related to your topic, Dr. Saiba, but if you would like to comment.
So when Imam gives didar, and when he says that Menaki Gunama, he has forgiven all the sins, that includes all the sins, definitely. Like all the things, including whatever we have done. But naturally, there are some reactions. If we have done something wrong, like we have to see that Imam has forgiven, but there are the laws. So when in the last lecture we said that fear of Allah is very merciful. We don't fear Allah, but we fear the laws of Allah. So there are laws, there are the laws, and if we have done something wrong according to that law, we will be given punishment, or like there is a reaction of that law. So because the laws of Allah or laws of Imam are there, but Imam is merciful to forgive us what are the things which we have done, most likely in which we have not paid attention to our spiritual progress and our intellectual progress, but in the worldly matter, if we have done something wrong, then we may, to reaction to that, we may get the reaction, like the punishment. Because the law of Imam or the law of Allah is still there. Imam is merciful, but we have to fear the law which is there all the time, for all the people.
Subhanallah. In other words, there are consequences one has to bear because of their whatever actions they have taken. Another question, Dr. Sava, I see is, I have known the story but not the esoteric interpretation. Simply amazing. Thank you very much. So you have done a beautiful job, Dr. Sava.
Can I ask something?
Please go ahead.
Yeah, you can ask, or maybe if anyone wants to add on something, please do that.
Yeah, it's actually, I did not need to add on. My name is Shiraz. I'm calling from London. A few months ago, I was listening to a lecture. This was within, you know, some Hindu community and everything. They were discussing Gita. And today, when you told the story of the birth of, you know, that he was put in a basket as a baby. So what they are saying is that this is a copy from our Gita. How do we to reply this question to them when they, you know, make this kind of accusation that these are all copy of the story from our Gita? When Mata Kunti also did the same thing with a baby and she put it in a basket and he grew up to be, you know, calm. Can you just throw some light on this, what they were discussing?
Yeah, so as far as, because these are all the narrations which is given in Tafsir, and also from, we have taken from Tafsir, Quran, the stories of prophets, and even in Hindu, there are few prophets have a similar kind of story. But until and unless we do not understand the esoteric meaning of these stories, then this really, like, this stories will not connect to us. So I think it may be taken from Gita. We cannot sure, because until and unless we identify the time and the history, it was happened. But many of the Qasis, Shia, Sunni, and even the historical literature is saying that this is happened. So this Hazrat Musa was gone to Fir'aun's castle, and he was being grown up there. So it was there. So maybe that was ritual or something which is coming from, because it's a Hindu mantra. Religion is before the time of Ibrahim. So there are something maybe common with them also. That's what I know, but if anyone would try to find out from the history or historical perspective,
I would simply say that when there's somebody who says accusations, I would say that's not a healing method. Things can be similar, things can be different. What matters, as Dr. Sahiba said, it's the Taweel. I think being Ismaili, we need to stay focused on the Taweel. And that leads me to the another question, which says, how does a mu'min get to the level of Musa's journey? Again, very broad question, if you can simply give us some guidance.
Yeah, so if we see the three steps, like Musa, first of all, taken a fish for his Ne'azam, and then doing Bandagi, and following all the necessary principles for going to the spiritual journey. So if we are doing all those obedience, Parman Bardari and Sniyasan, and then the Sniyasan will become automatic, then you will enter, automatically you will enter into the journey of the Sniyasan. So it starts from Sniyasan and also from ill, because only Ibadat is not important. Yes, Ibadat is important, but ill is also important. So there is this esoteric ill, knowledge, and Ibadat. Both are important. And Sneazam, Giriyavazari, all those principles of spirituality. If you follow all those principles, then definitely this is the path, same. Sneazam is the key, it's same for all of us.
The friend asks a follow-up question, how do you accelerate it? We all are here, want to run. How do we do that?
Yeah. So inshallah, if we follow and if we give our time, knowledge, prayer,
And I think there is a time where a piece that I think says that I have given nijat to that much in the food, and there are some people who went through all those interactions, who lead, and then we all can be the part of that person. So that is the fastest route. We can link with somebody who is at the leading position, and then we can say that, okay, we are with that person. So we are one with that person.
Any other friends who would like to unmute and ask questions? If you don't want to put it on the chat, you're welcome to do so.
Maybe any addition, Yasmin, if you would like to say something.
No, you've done beautifully. I guess one of the fastest way, as you just mentioned, right, have the bird balance.
I would like to share something, okay? I don't know how. Let me explain. So what happened is, I wouldn't dream, okay? I did quit, long story. So I wouldn't dream, and I heard that you have to dream. I heard in the Marceline, Esther, Alviva, that you have to dream. So I wouldn't dream. And then I sent a message that I don't dream. So she said, no, then something is blocked inside. And that made me, parishan, upset. And then I started talking to you, So, 2 days, maybe uski baat hi band ho gayi. He didn't talk to me, and I was like, so kidhar hai baat kar, but he wouldn't answer me. So then what happened is, my chanchi, who's in Boma, like I'm in Houston in Boma, I talked to her because she is a very, very spiritual lady, very. After, life took a U-turn for her, she got some cancer, and then she is on this path, like sometimes I wonder, wow, what if she doesn't know? So I told her about it, and she said, there are many things, like obstacles, maybe you're not sleeping properly, you're not sleeping on time. So I was, when she was explaining to me, I was going for hot yoga. I do yoga, like 6 days a week. So I was coming for hot yoga, I came up, I was convinced with the answer that it will take time, everybody is different. So then I went upstairs and I was lying on my mat and I told him, I said, abhi to kuch bol, I'm convinced. And he said, this is what came, the answer was from inside, is that Musa ka jo pyaar mere liye tha, wo alag tha, okay? And wo charwaha jo wahan bhed bakri chara raha tha, uska pyaar mere liye alag tha. So, and that was my answer. So, I didn't want to tell you sharing it. And I was very convinced. And then from there, my battery stopped. Okay.
Okay, that's all. Thank you so much for time taking and listening to me. I know that.
Thank you for sharing. So, we all have different kinds of experience. So, just I would say, quick comment mine is that when I say reaction, means reaction of what we have done. So it will affect basically in our spiritual journey. And we will see maybe what we were doing it and we have done something wrong, we call it zameer. So that is the zameer ki awaaz. So if your inner voice or inner self is alive, then that inner zameer is always keep on telling you that this thing is wrong, this thing is right, or you have done this thing wrong, now you have to correct. So this is the reactionary point. But the people who had buried their inner voice or zameer also, therefore those, it is very difficult because you have gone beyond the ethical law. So laws of Allah is not something written, it's ethical, it's beneath the boundary of Islam and within the boundary of Islam, and like you do not do bad to anyone. This is being taught in every religion, regardless of Islam, Muslim, we know. So this is the ethical principle which is laws of Islam, laws of Allah, and we have believed those ethical principles. But our inner self will guide you what we are doing. So that will give the reaction to. So when I say that reaction, in the spirituality, they will definitely give the reaction. I will just quote one Imam Farwan. That one morning, ask Imam Sutamasha that I am doing a lot of pandagi, I am going to Jamaatana regularly, I am doing seva, I am doing a lot of things that I don't feel like. So Imam said that, are you saying that either I am wrong or I am jhootha, like I am liar, or you have a fault because you are not doing all these things because tum bad nazar. I have heard this, I have read this, I cannot give you the reference of it. If I find the reference, I can give it, but I have heard this Parman many times in Alphabet lectures also. So that means that you do a lot of things, but still you do not get something, so you need to see what is inside yourself. It's your own examination of yourself is important. So that's how I said the reaction.
SubhanAllah, the way you talked about this inner voice, you know, and we have learned about carnal soul, conscious soul, and when one is asking, what do you do when the dreams stop? And that could be one of the reasons, Dr. Prabha, when you have this burden of sinning, then the reaction is that you don't see things in your dreams. That could be one. Would you agree with that?
You find the reason why it is so, why, what was the time you were doing when you were dreaming and now what is the time you are not doing well. So we always, like, we are up and down all the time. Sometimes we go spiritually very up and sometimes there is downfall. So we all have this kind of life, but we try to maintain at least the journey in a, like, moderate direction.
And there's another, and I would say this is the last question, and it says, if people like me can't be giving any service to Mala, the way we talked about seva, what can be the service? Like if physically they are not able to do it, what do they do?
So I will quote one hadith about that the Holy Prophet says that if you see somebody doing a sin, stop with your hand. If you cannot do with that, you can at least say something with that, okay, don't do, this is wrong, your thing. Even if you cannot do that one also, at least pray for them. So if you are praying for people, and if you are having this intention, good intention, a pure intention for people, this is a very good service. If you pray for all those who are afflicted, like for example, if you pray daily for Afghani people, if you pray daily for world of humanity, those who are suffering, and you keep remembering all those who are in suffering, and then with the remembrance you do Giriyavazari, this is a lot of seva. I think a more valuable than the physical seva.
I would like to share with you quickly, Dr. Rubina, that there are friends who daily pray for, you know, as a group for Jamaat. Currently, we are doing the zikr of Shahi Kareem al-Akram, preparing for Imam Salgira, our own, you know, personal words, soften it up so we can be close to Imam Noor. So yes, the group has realized the importance of zikr and prayer. So we are exactly doing what you are telling us to do. So thank you so much on this end. I will read one of the friends' comments. I enjoyed this forum where there's a discussion by all the speakers. I get a better insight. Thank you so much. Thank you for your input, Dr. Sagra. Wonderful, amazing presentation. We look forward to your second presentation next week, inshallah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.